Hey, welcome to church, everybody. Let's stand together. We worship a God who is faithful to his promise. He's faithful to his word. Let's celebrate that back today. Let's see those hands together. Let's sing this out.
Lord is a lamp unto my feet. Your way is the only way for me. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I want to be on it. It's a narrow road, but the mercy's wide, 'cause you're good on your promise.
We sing this out.
I'll take you at your word. If you said it, the chaos fell in. Well, I know, 'cause I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on it. Oh, it's the narrow road,
but the mercy is wide, 'cause you're good on your promise.
Church, can we celebrate that today? We serve a faithful Father. Yeah. shadows. Your love surrounds me. Yes. There's nothing to fear now, for I'm saved. Oh, so when I fight, I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh, Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you.
Yeah. mercy spoke for me. It was on Golgotha Street. His death brought liberty. His death brought liberty. His death brought liberty. May I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. And may I not forget the blood he shed. It is by his death I am alive. Because of Christ I am alive. Thank you, Lord. What a humble sacrifice. Love that washed me clean. Love that washed me clean. Love that washed me clean. What a blessed mystery. His punishment, my peace. His punishment, my peace. His punishment, my peace. May I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. May I not forget the blood he shed. It is by his death I am alive. May I never boast in anything except the cross of Jesus Christ. May I not of Christ, I am alive. Because of Christ, I am alive. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice for us. Hallelujah, hallelujah to the King of Kings. Lord, we praise your name. We praise your name, Jesus. You are worthy. And all God's people said, amen. Woo! Woo! Well, church, if you would please take your seat and turn your attention to the screens. We're going to celebrate the Lord's death and resurrection through baptism.
Amen. Good morning, church. I am super excited to share with you. These are our first baptisms for Harvest in Español. We've been doing it for 2 years. Amen. Estos son los primeros bautizos para nuestro ministerio de Harvest en Español y le damos gracias a Dios por su fidelidad. This is my brother Jose, and he's here to declare that Jesus is the Lord of his life. So, Jose, is Jesus the Lord of your life?
Yes, he is.
What has the Lord been doing in your life, brother?
He has taken me out of darkness, and I want to get baptized today because I want to give my life to Jesus just like he gave his for me. Many people think that coming to God makes everything easy, but it's not. It's not true. You become an enemy of the world, so you must become a soldier of God. Amen. But what is a soldier without a war or a mission? And my mission is to make disciples from many nations. Amen. By the way I act and talk. Amen. And live my life. I want to become the light of this darkness, all for the glory of God.
Amen. 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 So Jose, is it your desire this morning to be baptized?
Yes, it is.
Amen. So, because of your desire to be baptized, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I also have the incredible privilege of baptizing my own son this morning. Not only that, but he wanted his youth pastor to also share this with us. So, Mateo, have you made the Lord Jesus the Lord of your life?
Yes.
What has he been doing in your life?
I accepted the Lord when I was 5 years old, and I've always been in the church with my dad. And I've never really taken my faith seriously until I started high school. And I started serving in the church. I started going to youth group and using the resources that I got. And more recently, like at Camp Harvest, I had like an experience that was like beyond compare. I felt like I had a touch of heaven, and not only that, but not even a few weeks ago, I went through a tough time in a relationship, and I just had the most clarity I've ever had, and the most peace I've ever had, all because of him and worshiping him.
Amen, amen. So your desire to be baptized this morning?
Yes.
So, because of your decision, Mateo, we baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
We got a few more this morning, praise God. This is Susanna Pearson. Susanna, can you tell us a little bit about how you came to know Jesus as the Lord and Savior of your life?
I feel like I've always known Jesus. I was raised in a Christian home, baptized as a baby. I've never not known him, been surrounded by him my whole life in school. But fast forward to 2016, that brought us, my husband and I, here. It was a wreckage of our marriage, but it's exactly how God planned it. Because he makes masterpieces with broken pieces. And that's exactly what he did. He built me back together because I had been holding everything, everyone above him, not knowing. So he is the light of my life. He is my identity, and I need nothing else because of that.
Come on. Oh, that's good. So, since then, what has God been doing in your life? Where have you seen his fingerprints on you?
Yeah, still seeking things in the wrong areas, seeking approval of people, of man, but really just wanting his love more than anything. In the last year, I asked my husband, like, what do I do? What's my hobby? Like, whose am I? Like, I need to find my identity. And it's not just in being a mom, a mother, a wife, a daughter, a friend, which are lovely titles, but it's being a child and daughter of Christ. He's made that perfectly known to me.
That's good. So why do you want to get baptized today?
Surrender. It's a complete surrender and obedience to the Lord, and it's what he asks of us, and I'm so excited to do so.
All right. Well, then let's do so. All right. Susanna, upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Everybody, this is Caleb Samuel. Caleb, can you just tell us when you came to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yeah, so I grew up in like a Christian household, and like I always knew of God, but I never like truly knew him. It wasn't until like my 7th to 8th grade camp harvest where it was COVID year, and we were all outside worshiping, and I just prayed my prayer, and all my small group friends were around me, and they all put their arm on me, and I just really felt God's presence since then.
Praise God. And you decide to follow him, you're not looking back, right? That's right. So what has God been doing in your life since then?
He's just been working everywhere. He's given me, like, a real reason to live. And that's right. Given me the comfort in knowing that everything in this life can go wrong, and I still have the comfort of his true promise.
That's right. All right, Caleb, why do you want to get baptized today?
I just want to publicly proclaim my faith, and I want my church body to constantly remind me of why I'm here, and I just want to be held accountable, and I want to surrender to God.
That's right. Well, let's do that. Caleb, upon your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, everybody, this is Aaliyah Coelho. Aaliyah, can you just share with us how it is that you came to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
I've always known God. I've always kind of grew up in the church, but I didn't really lay down my life for him until last year.
Praise God. And what has he been doing in your life since then?
He really just has shown me the fruits of my labor, and he's given me clarity and guidance when I need him most, and shown me his love.
Yeah. Amen. All right, well, we're baptize you then, but why do you want to be baptized this morning?
I want to be baptized because I want to declare my love for the Lord publicly and to just be renewed in him.
Praise God. Well, let's do that. Aaliyah, it's upon your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Let's stand in response to the resurrected life we have in Christ.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died. Oh,
day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Buenos días, familia de Harvest. ¿Cómo estamos? Hello, everybody. Welcome to Harvest. It's great to have you here this morning to celebrate what the Lord is doing in our midst. My name is Christian. I get the privilege of serving as the pastor for Harvest in Español. We meet here in Rolling Meadows and Elgin every week. And of the last of the month, we come together to celebrate as one body. So if this is your first time here, we are so glad that you are here. And we would love to meet you and answer any question that you might have. If you're from home, please use the Connect card. It's in our new app at Church Center to let us know how we can serve you better as well. September 18, we celebrated 36 years of the ministry of Harvest Bible Chapel. Amen? But September 2004, our Elgin campus launched, and so we want to celebrate what the Lord has done through that campus. So would you please turn your attentions to the screens.
Back in the early 2000s, when Harvest was just one campus in Rolling Meadows, we were experiencing some incredible growth.
From 2000 to 2003, we doubled in attendance. By late 2002, we were running 6 shuttle buses in each Rolling Meadows service. It was getting very difficult, and the church seemed to be at a dead end.
The search began, where could the potential be for Harvest to build another location? By God's grace, the Green family reached out. It's a family who owns Hobby Lobby. They saw what we were doing at Disciples, making disciples, and they purchased this building and then sold it to us for $1.
It was now possible for us to keep our Rolling Meadows campus, build a new worship center in Elgin, establish a Christian school ministry on both campuses. It seemed far too much to undertake at once.
We were anticipating a good number of people. I remember we ran demographic studies of looking who would come out here. So we were building multiple classrooms for the kids on the weekend. In 2004, we opened the chapel side, and that's where we met for church.
I remember that first Sunday like it was no other day. It was packed, packed beyond what we could even handle. The next week, it was announced, hey, we're gonna have 2 services at our Elgin campus. Excitement was just in the air, and we could see God moving. We saw some significant increase in numbers, and it was like, Lord, we need some more space inside a building that seemed to be like so large. It seems like there needs to be an expansion plan.
Construction in Elgin has been a battle since it began. There have been many days that we have wondered how we'll get through. But as of October 2006, construction has begun in earnest again and is scheduled to be completed late in the summer of 2007.
I remember when we were getting this building ready to open in 07, we had a ton of our volunteers out working that last Friday before the first Sunday service, and we were setting up classrooms, getting the worship center seats screwed into the floor. It was all hands on deck, and we were getting everything ready. We have such a beautiful campus here at Elgin, and everybody is always struck by the windows and the trees and how gorgeous it is, and it is all of those things. But when you come inside, and we're here, the community of the people and the memories year after year that are happening on Christmas and in classrooms, and just being here and being together really makes this community into something beautiful.
This campus is 20 years old, Harvest is over 35 years old, and the people here still love the unapologetic preaching of God's word. You'll find great community here. People linger for an hour to an hour and a half after we are done. People praying for one another, building relationships with one another. They stay because they love one another and they love being here.
As I look back on all the things that have changed over time here, the Lord's faithfulness and his steadfastness is the constant throughout all of it. It's a story that God has written about his faithfulness to each of us.
Amen. Amen. And we thank God for his provision and for the ministry that he's doing through that Elgin campus in the last 20 years. We pray for churches because we don't do this alone. Today we're going beyond our state borders. We're actually going to go to Kentucky today. We're going to pray for Oak Hill Baptist Church in Sonora, Kentucky. And we're going to pray for Pastor Mitch Wyden. Would you please pray with me? Father God, you are so good, Lord. And it's so good to be in your house, to be reminded that you are moving in our church, that you, Holy Spirit, continue to work in us and among us, Lord, in amazing ways. Lord, we pray this morning for this church in Kentucky. May you use their pastor to speak and preach boldly from the word of God. May they be beacons of light in where you put them, Lord. We pray for our time together as well in the word of God. May they encourage us and challenge us to respond to what you have for us this morning. Thank you, Lord. We put the rest of this time in your hands. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. As we go to God's word, would you turn around and just welcome somebody to church this morning?
It occurred to me that I've been here 3 years as the teaching pastor, and I have never shared with you my favorite dad jokes. So I'm going to do this. Just so you, let's just be clear, this has nothing to do with the sermon. I just felt like it this week, and so I'm going to give you 8 dad jokes. I'm giving you 8 dad jokes because if you don't like one, there's more coming. And if at the end you didn't like any of them, okay, it's fine. So here's my 8 favorite dad jokes. My wife yelled from upstairs and asked, do you ever get a shooting pain across your body? Like someone's got a voodoo doll of you and they're stabbing it. And I replied, no. And she said, well, how about now? A caveman, and there's 8. Sorry, you got 7 more. It's okay. A caveman and a bear walk into a bar. The bartender says, what's your story? And the caveman replies, bear with me. Did you hear about the kidnapping at school? They woke him up. I went to a psychic. I knocked on the front door. She yelled, who is it? So I left. What has 5 toes and isn't your foot? My foot. people are usually shocked when I find out I'm not a very good electrician. We're almost done. It's okay. Two fish are in a tank. One turns to the other and asks, any idea how to drive this thing? I told that one to my wife the other day. It took her like a good half hour. And then about a half hour later, she's like, oh, a tank, like a boom tank. Yes, that's a good joke. Yes, it's a good joke, right? All right, finally, and what's twitching at the bottom of the ocean? A nervous wreck. Now, here's my awkward transition into the sermon that I, you know, you have to come up with a transition because I wanted to tell the dad jokes, right? Speaking of nervous wrecks, why is everyone one these days? You do know that, of course, that we live in a very interesting day when it comes to anxiety. Everybody talks about anxiety. We think about anxiety. We read about anxiety. Here's some statistics on anxiety in the United States. Anxiety disorders are the most common mental illnesses in the United States and affect over 40 million adults, or about 19.1% of the population. Generalized anxiety disorder is the most common anxiety disorder in the United States, with about 6.8 million adults affected. Young people are more likely to experience symptoms of anxiety than older adults, with nearly 50%, just listen to this, okay? 50% of those between the ages of 18 and 24 reporting depressive disorder or anxiety symptoms. If you are a college-age student, if you have like 10 college-age students that are standing in front of you, the statistic says that 5 of them struggle with anxiety. Women are more than twice as likely as men to experience an anxiety disorder. So young women are skewing that number even higher. That if you have 10 young women, it's a good chance that 7 out of them struggle greatly with anxiety. Now, when you and I hear those kinds of statistics, we all have our opinions, right? And we immediately want to get into a discussion, a good discussion, on, okay, why is it that in this particular day we struggle with anxiety, whereas maybe when I was a kid it wasn't quite like that? And so there's lots of reasons that we'll bring up. Like, this has got to be tied to social media. Like, it has to be that If you're constantly looking at the curated best life presented by a friend, it's not their real life. It's the best life presented by them. They took 8 pictures, and this is the one that they thought wasn't the worst. And they presented it to you in a curated form. You start thinking, my life's not like that. Their life's not like that, but my life's not like that. And if you have that from all of your friends, and they're all in Italy, you think, I'm not in Italy. What's wrong? And so you get a little depressed. And then you get anxious about why it is that your life isn't like that. Comparison is a dangerous, dangerous game. Other people will say, look, man, maybe it's just that we live in a day where it's just a therapeutic culture. So like in the 80s when I was growing up, if you felt sad, deal with it, dude. Nowadays, they got a label for you. So it's not that, you know, anxiety's not always been around. It's just that we really focus in on it now. And if you had asked a whole bunch of college students in the 80s, they wouldn't have answered the question, but they would have felt the feelings that those people are feeling. It might be that we just have access to so much information today that our hearts are overloaded with knowledge that we cannot bear. I know what's going on in Pakistan today. When I was a kid, I knew what was going on with my neighbor, maybe. Maybe what was going on in my town. And every night, if I was really bored, and at 6 o'clock, Peter Jennings or Tom Brokaw would come on the TV and say, "World News Tonight," which was just news about the U.S., but it's the World News Tonight, and you'd find out whatever it is that they thought was important. But now, if I'm online, I can find out about everything. I read the New Zealand Herald yesterday. I know what's going on in Wellington, New Zealand. And if you compound all the things that are happening in Wellington, New Zealand, with Budapest, Hungary, with St. Petersburg, Russia, and Chicagoland, and everywhere else, it's just too much. It's just overwhelming. It's just overwhelming. You eventually get just depressed by the state of the world, and then you get really anxious because you wonder if the things that are happening there are going to happen here. Look, there's lots of, we could have long conversations about this. It'd be fascinating to talk it through. Sit around a table and have these conversations. But it doesn't really matter what the causes are, because the end effect is that we are an anxious like most things, the Bible has something to say about this. Actually, it has quite a lot to say about it, about worry. One of the best passages about this is only 2 verses long. It's in the book of Philippians. It's Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. It's very easy for you to memorize. I encourage you, in fact, if you like scripture memory, even if you don't, this is one of those kind of sword verses that you bring out when you feel like you're under attack. Philippians 4, 6 to 7. Most of you have probably heard it before, even if you're not really involved in church. What I want to show you in this passage is, number one, how anxiety is a problem acknowledged by the Apostle Paul, and that makes us feel, I suppose, a little bit better, that it's not just our issue, it's always been an issue. Anxiety is a problem, that prayer is the solution, and that peace is the result. Anxiety's the problem, prayer is the solution, peace is the result, okay? So let's jump into this passage with those kind of 3 hangers to hang our thoughts on. Here's the first of them. Anxiety is a problem. You get into it immediately. Do not be anxious, Paul says, about anything. This is a command. You know, like, we have commands in the Bible, like love your neighbor. And we're like, ooh, that's an important one, right? You shall have no other gods before you, that kind of stuff. Well, this is a command. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. What I want to show you here, though, is that that idea of anxiety is not something that the Apostle Paul was not acquainted with. He knew what it was to feel anxiety because he was in the midst of some circumstances that would bring anyone to anxiety. So here's what's going on behind the scenes here. You know, every time you read a Bible passage, there's a whole context, not just context in the book itself. You know, we just jumped in at Philippians 4. There's a Philippians 1, 2, and 3. But there's a whole background regarding, like, who wrote it, what situation he's in when he's writing, what situation are the people in, why did he write it, all of that kind of stuff. So here's what's going on in the book of Philippians. Paul's in prison. He has received a gift from the Philippians, like a care package from the Philippian church. Everyone else in his life, for the most part, has left him, because if he's in prison and you decide that you're going to go and you're going to hang out with the guy in prison, that is a really good way for you to put a big target on your face and saying to the Roman authorities, who like to arrest people like Paul and his friends, I'm his buddy, look at me. I'm with the guy you put in prison for treason. So everybody was like, you know, we like Paul, but we're not going to be public about it. We're going to stay away. The Philippians weren't like that. One of the only churches that was like, no, we're actually, even if it brings on all sorts of attention that we don't want, we are going to go and we're going to help Paul. So they send one of their guys with it's a care package. It's probably got a blanket in it, because when you're in prison in those days, the state doesn't provide you stuff. You need to take care of your own food. You have to take care of your clothing, or you'll freeze. There's a whole bunch of things that you need taken care of. And so you need a friend. Well, he's got one who showed up and brought these sorts of things for him. So he's really thankful, and he writes this letter to the Philippians because he's super, super thankful to them for showing up. There's some question as to what kind of prison that he's in. So probably a kind of house arrest. By the way, does this mean he just has an ankle monitor and he's able to walk around and, you know, garden? He's chained to guards every day who work basically in like 4-hour cycles. So they chain me to Joe for 4 hours, and then they chain me to Jim for another 4 hours, and then they chain me to William for another 4 hours. Just all around the clock. He's constantly chained. So it's not like a house arrest that you and I would have. His friends have left him. There are teachers all over the place who have, because he's gone into prison, have started to be like, cool, Paul's out of the way. Now I can get my particular form of doctrine into the churches. They were people who believed the gospel, right? They agreed with Paul about the gospel, but they were like, he gets the rest of the stuff wrong. So they come in and they start correcting. So this guy has spent his whole life who planning these churches, hoping that they would flourish under really sound doctrine, have got people coming in behind him and are now there preaching other things. And he can't do anything about it because he's chained to a Roman guard under house arrest. So, and his life's work is at risk. He had lots of reasons for anxiety. Lots of reasons for anxiety. And yet here's the crazy part. If you go through the beginning of Philippians, you find these crazy phrases. Some of the stuff this guy says when he's reflecting on his present situation and all the things that are going wrong around him. Listen to what he says about his situation. He says, yes, I will rejoice. You'll do what? Can you imagine I'm sitting in prison? You know what I feel right now? Joy. I will rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. I actually think that because you guys are praying for me, I'm going to get out of prison. But there's a really good chance that he doesn't. So many people who went into prison for what Paul was in prison for die there. It's like a legit, he's facing death. As it's my eager expectation and hope that I will not at all be ashamed, but that with full courage, now as always, Christ will be honored in my body. So I'm facing death. I think I'm going to get out, but it doesn't matter because either way, whether by life or by death, for to me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. See, I'm cool with it, man. I've got joy because, you know, if they kill me, I get to be with Jesus. And if they don't kill me, I get to be with you sharing Jesus. Happy. What? That's what you guys do when everything goes wrong, right? You know, everything in your life is sad. You're facing, you know, a terminal illness or whatever. You're like, you know, sis, I'm joyful, man. I'm sorry. I'm not like that, but he is. And the verses just immediately prior, he says, so he's talking about these guys who are preaching behind him, who've come in and done these things. Some indeed preach Christ from envy and rivalry. Others from goodwill. So these guys who come in behind me, they just don't like me very much. And by preaching, they're kind of trolling me. But others, they preach from goodwill. The latter, the ones from goodwill, do it out of love, knowing that I'm put here for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition. They want to become famous, or they want money. Not sincerely, but thinking to afflict me in my imprisonment. Like the earliest trolls that we had were these people who were like, oh, I'm going to preach these other things so that Paul feels really rotten while he's in prison so I can add, you know, salt in his wound. What then, he says? By the way, my answer, what then here is,
I am going to pray God come down and smite every last one of them, and I'm going to get all my friends to go out there and tweet about it. That's me. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed. And in that, I rejoice. Isn't it great that Jesus is being proclaimed by all these people who want to troll me? That's what you feel like when somebody's trolling you, right? Hey, at least the truth's getting out. That passage just before that, when he's talking about like the fact that he's chained to these guards, which is not something that I would want to be dealing with. I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me, this imprisonment, has really served to advance the gospel so that it's become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. Can you imagine being chained to the Apostle Paul? I mean, this guy whose life has essentially been spent, my job is to proclaim Christ to the Gentiles, those who are not Jewish, but who are, you know, like Roman soldier type people. Ooh, here's a Roman soldier. They're pinning me to you? Well, hello, Servetus. How's it going? Let me tell you a few things. We've got 4 hours, you say? Well, let's begin at the beginning. In the beginning, God created that. You know, like, this guy who's a pagan is now pinned to Paul for the next 4 hours, and then they pick that guy up, and they're saying, we'll see you tomorrow, Servetus. Okay, Paul. And then in comes Theophilus. Pin him the other side. Theophilus, you know what that word means, right? Friend of God. Let me tell you how to be a friend of God. Can you imagine being pinned to this guy? Hey, I'll see you tomorrow. See you tomorrow. Round the clock. He's got a captive audience of guards. And so he's like, isn't this amazing? Isn't this amazing that my imprisonment for the gospel has given me access now to a group of people who would never be preached to, a group of Gentiles who'd never be preached to if I wasn't in prison for the gospel. And in that I will rejoice. Isn't this great? You're pinned to me. You know, at the end of the book, it says, all those of Caesar's household greet you. So they believed. Of course they did, probably because they were like, okay, fine. I agree. My point here is that this guy has all these reasons for anxiety. All the stuff that causes us to, the circumstances of his life have gone completely pear-shaped, as they say in New Zealand. And he's got joy. What does he know that I don't know? What is the secret that he knows that I don't know when it comes to dealing with anxiety? Because it's not just about a few things. Listen to what he says. Do not be anxious about anything. There is not a circumstance in your life, he says, where anxiety should happen. I find that to be some of the most difficult words in the Bible because I just don't understand how he can say that. Anxiety is a genuine issue for people like me. I don't know if you've seen the Pixar movie called Inside Out. If you haven't, it's a clever little story. It's about a young girl who has these emotions who are running basically her brain. And she's got joy, and she's got sadness, she's got disgust, she's got fear, and she's got my favorite, anger. And they are all sitting, they're all at a table, a control table, and at different points, different ones take over. And so this is the filmmaker's way of saying, this is what it's like to be us, is that we have different emotions that take over at different times. And joy is in charge, you know, because she's a little girl. It's a great movie. It's a lot of fun to watch. So they made a second one, and she goes through puberty. And when she goes through puberty, they add characters to the table. They still has the same ones there, but now she has new characters, right? Like embarrassment. And anxiety shows up. And anxiety takes over. It's like anxiety grabs hold of the controls and starts thinking about all the fears that she should have and starts controlling everything. And there's this crazy scene where she desperately wants to be liked by her friends. And so she's trying to make the hockey team. And she ends up going too hard and everyone's mad at her. And she goes into the penalty box. And as she's sitting there, they zoom into her head. And these characters are there. And anxiety's in there. And anxiety has basically pushed everyone aside. And is moving at light speed in this tornado, gripped with fear. And she on the outside is sitting there shaking. This is the filmmaker's way of saying that this is what happens when you have a panic attack. That anxiety takes over. It's actually quite a brilliant image. Arthur Summers Roche, an old author, he said, anxiety is a thin stream of fear trickling through the mind. If encouraged, it cuts a channel into which all other thoughts are drained. It's a thin stream of fear that runs through the mind. But if it's encouraged, if water is added to it, eventually it'll just cut in so that everything falls into it. And if you have ever struggled with anxiety in your life, you know that's the case. You watch a movie like Inside Out 2 and you're watching it and going, I know the shaky feeling. I know it. So I was diagnosed with a major depressive disorder 8-9 years ago, something like that. They gave me medication for it, and I've just been a fight ever since. I've had episodes in my past, and it's part of the reason why they diagnosed me with these sorts of things is because I've had episodes in the past where I freak out, right? I had a really bad one when I came to Harvest. I was in a meeting, and in the meeting, it finally occurred to me, I'd been here about 6 months, and it finally occurred to me how many problems there were. See, when I came, they said, there are problems. And I'm like, yeah, sure. Every church has got problems. Okay. But we're ready to move forward, as they said. Yep, mm-hmm. I'm ready to move forward. They're ready to move forward. I'm willing to, you know, go leave the ministry that I had. It was really great ministry and all our friends and leave and go to Chicago and start this ministry. Move your family. Start your daughter in school. Boys coming along with me. Don't know anybody. We show up. We start getting involved and realize, oh, that was a problem that you guys kind of mentioned, but if I were in your shoes, I would have mentioned that one a lot bigger than what you said. And then here's this one over here, and I would have said that one was bigger, and then that one was bigger, and then that one was bigger, and this one, and here's four that you didn't mention. And I remember sitting in this meeting, and we were having a conversation about all of these issues, and then people were adding other issues, like fundamental, challenging issues to the church. And I was sitting there thinking to myself, what have I done? I moved my entire family to join a dumpster fire. Like, it felt, you know, no offense, but like, it felt like there was this tornado whipping around me, and I would be like, oh, there's a problem, oh, there's another problem, and there's another problem, there's another, and eventually I was just started to, I just started to sit there and shake. And I said, I remember praying, Lord, please not now. Please not now. I'm trying to pretend that I know what I'm doing with these dear people. And I started to shake. And about 5 minutes after just trying to keep myself calm, I just lifted my head and said, I'm so sorry, I'm having a panic attack. And I said, I have to go. And I stood up from this leadership meeting. I started to walk out. I heard when I was walking out, I heard someone say, has he lost it? And I was like, I wanted to turn and say, I never had it. Just so you know, like I told you, I didn't have it. I walked out and I felt my entire body convulse into moaning as I was walking down the hallway. Isn't this great? We hired a new pastor, and then he left the meeting and moaned all the way down the hallway. And I was like, this is awesome, God. I stared at the wall in my empty office and just cried out loud. I was worried that people were going to hear me and all sorts of things. So I thought I'd tell you about it. Look, you don't need to have had a panic attack to know what anxiety is. It's a spectrum, right? It works from, hey, I'm a little concerned about this, to it's keeping me up at night, to there's not a whole lot of moments in the day where it's not sitting there as kind of an underlying baseline in my life, to I'm freaking out. You know what I mean? Of course you know what I mean. Some of you, are somewhere on that spectrum now. So when we come to a passage of scripture that starts to talk to us about how to fix this or how to change it or how to address it, we immediately want him to tell us what it is that he knows. He will. Can I pause the sermon right here just for a second? Some of you are like, thank God. Right? Can we go to the bathroom? No, just... let's pause this, push it over here for just a second. Look, there's a thing that we kind of have to talk about as church people. There is a fight among Christians about how we should understand the medication that goes into this. On the one side, there are a group of Christians who say, listen, Jesus can heal all of your sicknesses and illnesses and all of the things, and that when he comes into your heart, there is joy and there is peace. So if you're not feeling that joy and peace, the problem is spiritual, and you don't need to go and get someone to tell you what you have or don't have, and you don't need to go get medication. In fact, some even go so far as to say that getting that medication is an act of unbelief, right? That you should believe more in what Jesus said, and that's the issue. That's the issue that you need to deal with. And so they make these big comments, and they talk about how psychiatry is quackery or whatever, and psychology is terrible. And then against that, over there, are these people who are Christians and his psychologists and psychiatrists have done this study and understand the brain and how it works and realize that actually, you know what? Part of the fall is that it's influenced, yes, our bodies, but also our minds. And so as a result, we are a broken people, and some of that breakage can be addressed with medication. So we shouldn't say medication's a bad thing, and the others say, yes, we should say medication's a bad thing, it's unbelief. No, we shouldn't say that at all. You're hurting people. You're hurting people. And you get in these fights, okay? So as somebody who is well acquainted both with the fights and with the issue itself, just in terms of my experience, let me tell you where I fall on this. I think both of them have a point. I think that the latter, meaning the counselors and the psychiatrists, I think they have a point. Because mental health is affected by the fall. Just like physical health is. And if you have diabetes and you go and you get your insulin, nobody's standing there going, I think you're making it up. Maybe you just need to think about better things. Maybe if you just change your diet. Oh, but diet might help, but sometimes you just have diabetes. And isn't it a kind, common grace of God that he ends up giving us insulin? I thank God that he gave insulin. Doctors who developed it, companies who produce it, it's amazing that we can actually treat that kind of thing. And so we are people, yes, with body, but we also have a soul. And I don't think that what we do with the body in terms of treating it and what we do with the soul, they're mingled. And so medication can be a really good thing. But medication doesn't usually deal with the cause of mental health. Like I said, we are body and soul. And so science has everything to do with the physicality. It has everything to do with the brain. But the brain and the mind are not the same thing. If we go to the Bible and we ask, what is a human being? We would say it's a material and immaterial thing. Science is going to deal, medication is going to deal with the material side. But if you really want to get to the root of an issue with human beings, you have to address the soul. So those people who say, hey, we should be dealing with this with spiritual things, yes, I'm like, uh-huh, soulish kind of answers. Both is my answer. Medicine is good, but it's not enough. The cause has to be addressed. I have heart disease, and so they give me medication, but I've had to change what I eat. Oh, I hate it. I dream about pizza. I love pizza. I miss pizza so much. Pizza, come back, right? But I have to deal with the source. So here's the question. How do you deal with the source of anxiety? How do you treat the soul? What does Paul know that we don't know? Well, he knows that prayer is the solution. Here's the passage. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, you see the comparison, in anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. So here's the main cause. Do not be anxious, but let your requests be made known to God. That's the main point. Don't be anxious, but let your requests be made known to God. Now, here's what's interesting about this passage. He qualifies the let your requests with three different phrases. Here they are. Do not be anxious about anything, but here it is. In everything, by prayer and supplication, and with thanksgiving. So it's not just any prayer. It's this kind of prayer. What kind of prayer? Well, in everything prayer. Meaning in every situation. There's not a single situation that you cannot pray in or that prayer should not be the first option. And for you and me, that's not usually the case, is it? When we face a difficult moment, like God forbid some bad news happens later this afternoon and you end up getting that news, and you start, the first thing that we tend to do is, how do I fix it? Let's make a plan. Let's get together. We have to have a plan. Who's got the spreadsheets? Let's do a pros and cons list. Let's make it happen, man. We pray for a second, but very rarely is it like, you know what we should do about this? Is pray immediately, because it's the most effective thing. If you say that, somebody will come along and say, this is the kind of thing, problem that prayers and thoughts will not answer. We gotta act. Yeah, because we're doers. You know why I do this, of course, is because my theology stinks. When I act this way, it's because I'm acting like what we call a deist. That I believe that God exists, but I just believe he's not that involved. The way that God has done things is he's sort of left it to us to sort the stuff out. So I don't know, he's on vacation or whatever. It's very much in the way I think about the world is I'm in a room, there's a bee. I hate bees. There's a bee, it comes in. I'm sorry, a wasp. Some people are like, you don't know bees. Okay, a wasp comes in. And I'm sitting there, and my wife, who broke her hand just the other day, she punched me too hard. She fell off her bike, but the punching things probably happened too. So she's injured, and she's sitting there, and I'm sitting there. And in my mind, I'm like, well, the only person who's going to be able to deal with this bee is me, because she doesn't have the capacity to do it. This is the way most of us tend to view our lives, is the controller of all the things in our lives is me. I make it happen. So if it's gonna happen, I gotta get up there and start trying to get the bee. The problem is, it's exactly the opposite. The one who has the ability to get the bee is God, and the one who is injured is me. In the room of my life, the only one capable of actually handling the issues completely and thoroughly is God. If he commands me in some way to actually offer assistance, then I can do that. I swear, most of us in our lives, what we're doing is we're swinging at all the bees in our life, and God's over there with a massive fly swatter going, you can ask, right? I can get it. I can get it. No, no, it's fine. It's fine. I can do it. No, you can't do it. You can't do it. In everything. It's not a situation that goes by. In everything. By prayer and supplication. There's an English word, if you ever decide English grammar, which of course for some of you is like, I don't think so. If you ever study English grammar, there's a word called hendiadys. A hendiadys is when you use two words to describe one concept, right? Thoughts and prayers, hopes and dreams, sadness and loneliness, whatever. And the idea of a hendiadys is using the two words because you're trying to communicate that it's not just what these two words convey, it's all the stuff like it. So when he says, by prayer and supplication, it's a hendiadys, and he's essentially saying all kinds of prayers. All kinds of prayers. So listen, I know that there are pastors in the world who will say, if you really want to pray, you got to do it in this way. You got to go in a room, you got to knee, you got to do, like there's a whole bunch of things that they'll say. The problem is a passage like this is saying, no, all the kinds of prayers are great. Like the alone on the couch prayers, the on the knees prayers, the prayers that you pray just like between one room and the next room, the help me God in the midst of a horrible moment prayers, all of those prayers. So in everything, in every way, with thanksgiving, with thanksgiving. Why? Why do I have to give thanks? And here's the important piece of this. When I give thanks to God, what it's doing is it's reorienting my mind around proper theology. Remember what I said? The problem with me is that I don't go to prayer because my theology stinks. I don't think the right things about God. When I give thanks in the midst of my prayers, what I'm doing is I'm saying God is alive, present, and powerful in my life. And he's for me. You ever take your kid and they're complaining about a particular, they maybe ask you a question like, oh, because you did this, you don't love me. And you know, here's the solution. Young parents, you take that kid, you take him by the shoulders and say, okay, let's recount all the things in the room right now that are yours because I'm nice. All of this stuff, let's call it out. Doom, boom, doom, boom, boom, boom. Okay, now we're gonna go to the next room and talk about the food in the cupboard, and then we're gonna go out to the car that you ride in all the time and the bike that you ride, and then we're gonna go to your school, and then we're gonna go to the bank account, and then your entire life is here because of grace. Eventually, the kid is like, oh yeah, okay. I see what you're getting after. What I've done is I've reframed their question and their complaint by saying this small issue, this momentary problem, needs to be put in the wider framework of all the grace and gifts that I have given you. If you want evidence of my love for you, just look around. So when we give thanks to God, this is what we're doing. I have a bike that I love. It's amazing. I rode like 90 kilometers yesterday, which is a lot. So I love this bike. There's a noise in the crank. You know, like when you turn the pedal, there's a noise in the crank and it drives me crazy. And I found myself yesterday while I was riding this bike enjoying everything this bike has to offer, and just it feels so good, and it's right size, and everything's just so great while I'm riding it. The wind is blowing, and but all I could think about was this crank has a click in it. I hate the click. Why do I have this bike? This is wicked and evil. I should never bike again because of this click in the crank. You have a beautiful view from your house, and you're like, I hate that tree. You drive a Porsche, and you're like, this steering wheel is that far off. And all of us want to, when you say that, grab you by the shoulders and go, first world problems, dude. Like, what? Look around you. Look at how wonderful this whole thing is. You're so focused on this one issue. Right. What you need to start doing is you need to start giving thanks in the midst of the problem. Problem's not going away, but you need to frame the problem with thanksgiving. The Apostle Paul, actually, in 1 Corinthians, the Corinthian church was not a church that he was like, yay, Corinthians, you're so great. If you read his letters to them, they get really mean. There are places, in fact, where he questions whether many of them are saved. If a fist could come out from the book, you know, when they open the thing, it would be a punching them repeatedly type thing. And yet at the beginning of 1 Corinthians, here's what he says. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that was given you in Christ Jesus, that in every way you were enriched in him in all speech and all knowledge. Now, he's later in the book going to get have a go at them for the way that they use their speech and knowledge. But before he does, he's like, but the fact that you have it is evidence of God's grace in your life. Even as the testimony about Christ was confirmed among you so that you're not lacking in any gift. These gifts, which, by the way, you guys use in a really ridiculous way, but you have them because of the grace of Christ as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus, who will sustain you to the end, guiltless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, some of you, I don't know if you're a Christian or not, but he will sustain you. Can you feel it? Thanksgiving in the prayer. My old church, we used to get together our pastors' meetings, and before we did anything else, we had to share all sorts of issues that we were going to face. Before we did anything else, we ended up saying, all right, let's share evidences of God's grace. We need to know where the Lord is showing up so that we can give thanks to the Lord for the first half an hour before we get into all the problems. You should be making a regular habit of giving thanks to the Lord for all the ways that he is acting in your life so that the issue that you're dealing with is framed properly and you understand who it is you really are praying to. So anxiety is a problem, prayer is a solution, and peace is the result. Look at this last section. This is short. I'm going to read the whole passage. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. The peace of God, the sense that all is right with the world. You know, of course, that God has never had a moment in his existence where he has been anxious. Ever. There's never been a moment he's like, oh, I wish this would be different. This is so horrible. I didn't see this coming. Never. He's never had this moment. The peace of God, this sense of overall well-being, will go into your hearts and your minds, the immaterial part of you. And what it's going to do there is it's going to guard your heart and your mind. That's a word that's a military word that's used for how they guarded like a garrison would guard a fort. So the image he's trying to say is, look, God is going to station the battalion at the entrance of your heart. And they're going to march back and forth with their massive guns. And every time they see anxiety poke its stupid head up over the horizon, that's what he's going to do. The peace of God will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, but the two pieces that are so helpful for me are these two. It surpasses all understanding, and it's in Christ Jesus. It surpasses all understanding. You know, the normal way in our world that peace comes is by a change in circumstance, right? This is why when you want to draw a picture of peace, you draw a picture of you in the snowy cabin with floor-to-ceiling windows, and the snow is drifting down, and there's a wood fireplace there. And you have your lap dog and your blanket and your favorite drink, and you're looking out at the, because the environment is just, everything is just, you never draw pictures of downtown Chicago on Wacker Drive. You're not thinking, you know what brings me peace is being down there lost forever. You don't. You're not thinking, well, I-90 gets really busy sometimes and people try to cut me off. I'll draw that for peace. No. When you're down there and then you leave there and you come back to the suburbs, that's why you live in the suburbs, then you come back and you get to your house, you sit in your chair and go, anxiety to peace because of a change of circumstance. That's the normal human understanding of how you, that's why you pray the way you do, that's why I pray the way I do. God changed the circumstance. But he's not talking about that kind of peace. He's saying there is a kind of peace of God that's never troubled even though the storm is raging. It's the kind of peace that Jesus himself has when he's on a boat and the storm's going crazy and he's asleep. And his disciples, you don't care. Don't you get it? The way it just works is if we're in trouble, we freak out. And Jesus is like, not if you know what I know. So what does he know? What does Paul know? Well, guys, they left it to the end. That you're in Christ Jesus. That if you have put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and you have said to him, I cannot do my life on my own. I've tried it. I have pushed my way and tried to figure it out all the ways that I think are right, but I need to give up all of that. I'm going to turn it over to you, Lord, and I'm going to go where you go. I'm going to follow you no matter what to the end of my days so I can spend the rest of eternity with you and the joy of your Father. If you've made that decision, what's happened to you is that you have been joined with Christ. You have a union with him. So that, similar to what the union is of Iron Man with the Iron Man suit, that they're indivisible as Iron Man, that when you are joined to Christ and you are in Christ, then everything that Jesus, the suit, can do is something you're able to do. Everything that happened to Jesus has happened to you. So you have been crucified with Christ. You have suffered with Christ. You have died with Christ. You will be raised with Christ. You will have the blessings of eternity that are owed Christ because you're in it. Not because you're great. You can't blast things like this. But Jesus does and can if you know this. If you know that you're in Christ Jesus and that all the massive questions of your life are settled because of what he's done by his grace, then it changes the way you understand the storm of anxiety. Look, I'll finish with this. It's Halloween season now, right? And some of us crazy people are going to go and we're going to try to go to those haunted houses. And we walk into the haunted house, you know what you're doing? You're walking into an actually stressful environment. If you didn't know that and your friends are like, it'll be fun. I'm a pastor from God. I'm telling you, it's not fun. It's stressful. A lot of anxiety. And there's going to be some dude with a fake mask who's got blood. It's not blood, it's ketchup. It's like dripping down their face, and they'll have a chainsaw. And they'll do a jump scare. They'll jump out. And in that moment, you'll be like, but you won't run. And here's why you won't run. Because you know what this is. You know who you are. You know what this whole situation is. You know that the guy, if he were to touch you with a chainsaw, you'd be like, I'm rich. And so you're going to walk out. And you'll freak out for the second, but then you'll have a peace. That doesn't, by the way, you shouldn't have in a situation like this. There's a mass murderer trying to get you. And you're like, no, I'm a little tired. And the reason you're able to do this is because you have a broader viewpoint about what's actually going on. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, I am telling you that if your broader viewpoint includes who God is, who you are in Christ, where you're headed, there is a possible kind of peace for the people of God that surpasses all understanding. It's a peace you need. It's a peace you want. And it's yours by prayer. So don't be anxious about anything. But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for your word. And I pray, Father, that the secrets that are unveiled here would be things that overwhelm us. You know, we come to church, Father, so that we can hear from you, and I pray we've heard from you, and I ask, Lord, that this particular issue, which plagues all of us, this anxiety, that you would help us to overcome so much of it. Help us to remember in thanksgiving all that you are, all that you've done, all that you are doing, our position in Christ, Father, so that we too can sleep in a storm. Would you help us? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. This morning we're going to celebrate and be reminded of the work that Christ did on the cross to bring us hope and to give us that peace. And so we're going to do that by sharing communion. I'm going to ask the ushers to come up to the front. We are going to pass the elements, but we will sing together, and then we'll come back and take the elements together after we sing. But remember that this is a family meal. That means that if you have something against somebody in this family, this is the time to go and make it right. But also, if you are not part of this family, you can let those elements pass, but we would love to talk to you about what it means to have that relationship with the Lord. We will have people here at the end that will love to talk to you, okay?
For I am his, and he is mine.
Luke 22, verse 19 tells us, and he took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. También tomó pan, y después de dar gracias, lo partió, se lo dio a ellos, y dijo, esto es mi cuerpo entregado por ustedes. Hagan esto en memoria de mí. Let's take the bread. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. De la misma manera, tomó la copa después de cenar y dijo, esta copa es el nuevo pacto en mi sangre, que es derramada por ustedes. Let's take it. Please, stand up. Let's sing together.
No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry till final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man could ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ.
I pray that you have been motivated today to be reminded who Christ is. We would love to meet you. There's going to be people to pray here. We would love to meet you in the lobby. And don't forget this week that you are loved.